I'd like to welcome you to the multiple mini interview town hall. Tonight you will hear from our keynote speakers, Dr. Frank Sousa and Mr. Roy Roy, admissions leadership at the University of California Davis School of Medicine, who have utilized the MMI in their admissions process for over 3 years. This town hall is to provide you with information that on the MMI and provide you with the look and feel of an MMI station interview and to answer any questions that you may have as our school moves forward with this interviewing method. In the past, the medical school has used traditional interviews. And initially, they were blind interviews in that you got no metrics and no personal data on the applicants. And you were interviewed by a faculty member that was a member of the admissions committee and a current medical student. Currently, we are using two 30-minute semi-blind interviews. You do, as an interviewer, you receive the personal statement of the applicant, but you're still interviewed by a faculty member and a current medical student. We now have structured question banks, and we do have, they were not called domains in the past, but we had characteristics and things that we were looking for in our interview, and there were about 8 of them. And so these structured questions are based on for us to get a more objective look at our applicant. And that these objectives and things that we were looking at align with the mission and objectives of our school. So the strength of a traditional interview was that it was personalized and it was one-on-one discussion. The weaknesses was that the inter-rater reliability, subjectivity, and biases, both conscious and unconscious, were creeping into our results, and the weight of the interview score was 50-50. So, like any program, this process had worked well for us over the years. And we have matriculated some excellent students who turned out to be excellent physicians. However, all processes can be improved upon, and the interview measure is the one that has the significant impact on the admissions committee and their decision-making process while reviewing applicants. The committee found that increased biases, conscious and unconscious, come to play in when applicants are being interviewed. So we started looking at the many interviews of MMIs because we wanted to be much more objective in what we were looking for in our applicants. So when we looked at the strengths of the MMI, the inter-rater reliability, validity, decreased biases, conscious and unconscious, was at the top of the list. The fact is that you got 8 to 10 assessments compared to 2 assessments, and the empirically structured, research-structured MMIs would meet the measures that we were looking for in an applicant. Now, the weakness to the MMI was a cultural change. There was the perception that you lost that personal touch, but for us, we have an interview day, so the applicant is brought in, not just be brought in for the interview, but would meet with medical students, faculty, and be shown around the campus. And the other weakness is that it would require more faculty input. We need more faculty members if we're doing the MMIs, because there would be at least 10 stations that have to have interviewers for that process. We're talking about implementation in the 2014-15 admission cycle. We need participation and service on the admissions selection committee, which is the interviewing group of faculty members and medical students. And this means that the faculty has to be engaged and advocate for this MMI process. As will be discussed this evening, the empirical research indicates that the MMI decreases the effect on the applicant's assessment, as well as significantly increases the internal rater reliability and the validity of the measures. Applicants are being assessed on the same constructs based on the domains that have been assigned and aligned to set with our school mission and objectives. The MMI stations have been empirically researched and are measuring what we want to be measured, the validity. So as we move forward on the implementation of the MMI 2014 to 2015 admission cycle, faculty involvement is really important. Engagement, advocacy, and service on the admission selection committee to perform the interviews will be key to this transformation. Tonight you will hear testimonials and outcomes from our peer institution, experience a marked MMI, and hear from the dean on his support and advocacy of the MMIs for our admission process. I would like to turn the program over to our dean, Dr. Thomas L. Swan.
Thanks, Ben. Let me add my welcome to those of you who are here to experience this and to be trained. This is critical to engage all of you, more of you, in this process. It's a much more complex process, much more expansive process. And as you know, we're talking about even more expansion related to the future of a statewide school that will have full campuses. That's one of the issues for me in this process, which is we're going to be faced with a much more aggressive enrollment management and pipeline process down the road as we think about a more expansive mission in the state. And we really have to think much more aggressively about how we engage with potential applicants, how we bring them into the system, the nature of the process, what they experience. Part of this process is selection, part of it is recruitment. And we really have to work hard, I think, to develop a more expansive, a more inclusive, a more diverse type of experience. The bigger issue for me, though, is actually the pipeline issue from admissions to curriculum to the eventual practice of medicine. As you all know, the practice of medicine has changed dramatically. Much more patient-centered, much more personalized, much more personal, much more attention to engaging with patients and with really complex problem-solving, ethical dilemmas, behavioral issues. It's a way different ballgame than when I was being interviewed at the University of Michigan and basically presented your transcript and had a few questions. And to some extent, the degree process has stayed like that for a long time in many schools. I think that as we transform our curriculum in response to changes in practice, we have to transform admissions in response to the curriculum so that the entire process is aligned, and I think this does that. I think this gives us much richer data, much more expansive data about the nature of these applicants, their personality, their thinking processes, their cognitive processes, their ethical system for making decisions. It's a whole different approach. Whenever there's a change like this, we always have to ask why, because the default position is always easier. We've done fine like this up until now. Why don't we continue to do fine like this? And I think the answer is because we are not really properly aligned with dramatic changes in education and dramatic changes in practice, and I think this pulls us into that. So I'm very excited about this. I'm personally very supportive and very enthused. Final thing I'll do is just thank those who have been so aggressive about managing this process. Our admissions staff, Chris and Jody and Robin and Ann and others have been so good about digging into this and really becoming incredibly expert and are incredibly important to this process, and I just want to thank you guys for putting together this and everything to take us along. Good. So let me introduce our guests who are so kind to come from Sacramento to help us with this. Let me introduce Dr. Frank Sousa and Mr. Roy Rye. Dr. Sousa is the Assistant Dean for Admissions and Student Development at UC Davis, has spent nearly his entire career at UC Davis, except for 1 year at the University of Michigan, which I will proudly claim. He was an intern when I was a senior student. Fairly good chance we ran across each other at the VA, if nowhere else. He's an ophthalmologist and continues to practice and has been very involved in student pipeline issues and diversity issues and outreach issues, interdisciplinary education, is very smart about all things related to admissions and student programs. Mr. Roy Rye comes to us from UC Davis as well, where he is the Chief Administrative Officer of the Office of Medical Education, came to Davis from the Beta Fiber Harvard Cancer Center, and both of them have incredible experience with the MMI. So they're going to take us through some materials, and then I'm going to reappear later. So, welcome to you, and please welcome our guests.
Good evening. I'm Frank Sousa.
Roy. Thank you for inviting us.
Yes. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for the wonderful tour this morning. We really enjoyed seeing the campus here in Las Vegas. We really have a wonderful facility. So hopefully we can add some information about our interview process and hopefully be helpful to you folks. So if we could go ahead with the first slide. Okay. I'm Francis Susan.
I like to give Roy a bad time because on interview days I introduce him as the Chief Administrative Officer of the Office of Medical Education, and the applicants kind of go like this. I say, or in English, he runs the show. So we call this MMI 101. This is a presentation that we gave to the Western Group on Educational Affairs, I think 3 years ago, in teamwork with the University of Arizona Phoenix, as well as the University of California, Los Angeles. So, some of the issues that we're going to cover.
Go ahead, sit. It's okay. Let me do the click. It's okay. You good. Go ahead.
So some of the issues that we're going to discover is, what is the MMI? Why do we do the MMI? What our voyage at UC Davis School of Medicine has been? What your journey might be? And that's going to depend on what you want. Because one of the nice things about the MMI is that there's a lot of parameters that you can define for yourselves as school. And then we'll have a sample story. So, this is part of our training process. The reason why we show this.
Help you? Yeah, this dude gave me this card. Help out here.
You guys can hear it, right?
We show this as part of our routine training for all MMI graders. So notice we don't call them interviewers, we call them graders.
My name is Zed.
You're all here because you're the best of the best. Marines, Air Force, Navy SEALs, Army Rangers, NYPD. And we're looking for one of you. Just one. What will follow is a series of simple tests for motor skills, concentration, stamina. I see we have a question.
I'm sorry, maybe you already answered this. Why exactly are we here?
Son?
Second Lieutenant Jake Jensen, West Point, graduate with honors. We're here because you're looking for the best of the best of the best. Sir!
That's not a school interview, right?
What's so funny, Edwards?
Your boy Captain America over here. Best of the best of the best, sir. With honors. You know, he's just really excited and he has no clue why we're here. That's very funny to me. No, he laughed.
Notice they're all in their little egg shells there.
Okay, let's get going.
So we show this for a couple of different reasons. One is that we want to make the point to our potential raiders that we're interviewing for medical school. We're looking for some very important qualities in folks. But those qualities aren't necessarily the same qualities that Google's looking for, or that Microsoft is looking for, or that IBM is looking for, or that even Ford Motor Company or any major corporation. We're looking for a set of human qualities that is somewhat intangible, but can be distinguished. And I think this episode shows that. And they're figuring out how to solve the problem, how an individual thinks on their feet, how they're able to wrap their head around. On the blackboard. But there are some simple solutions to problems, right? And so these are some issues that we're looking for. So this is kind of a way of in our training, and we're glad to share this training that we have with you folks. If you want, you can cut and paste however you want. The MMI is called an admissions OSCE. We're all familiar with OSCEs. We do them all the time. The difference is that it really isn't objective. It's subjective. It's one person's opinion of what that interaction is, but it's done multiple times. So rather than one person doing it one time, or two people doing it one time, it's, in our case, 10 people doing it one time. So it's subjective, not objective. It is standardized, very standardized. So every applicant has almost exactly the same experience. Ours are not clinical. We stress to our applicants right up front on their interview day that we are not going to be having anything to do with clinical medicine. That's why they're coming to medical school, is to learn to be doctors, and we don't expect them to know anything. If they have some clinical knowledge, great, but that's not important to us. It's not what we're looking for. We're looking for just qualities about and attributes of their person, just like we want them to be looking for qualities and attributes of our school. And it is an evaluation. So it's standardized and it's an evaluation, but it's not objective and it's not clinical. So it is multiple short stations. You can pick however many you folks want to do. The research, as if you've looked at it, pretty much you have to do at least 6 to have it come out reliable. We do 10. They're, like I said, very structured. What I particularly like about the MMI is that it's highly flexible. So each institution, and you folks have gone to different institutions, each institution will do it a little differently. I like to joke around with our applicants, and I say, I'm gonna say completely objectively, our MMI is the best in the country. And they kind of get a chuckle out of that. But I'll explain to you maybe a little later why I personally feel that way. But it's highly flexible. You can make your MMI whatever you want it to be. It does measure interpersonal skills, which, as we all know, come the third and fourth year, become very valuable qualities and attributes of our students. And it is a measure of non-academic. And it's not really objective, so throw that part out. Okay. So, maybe you've seen this slide. This was a slide done by an analyst who was trying to show they had a group interview situation where they had three folks doing interviews, or five, I think it was, at the University of Kansas. But anyway, the point here is that if you have multiple interviewers on one assessment, first of all, you pick a set of qualities like you folks have picked. You picked, I think you said, eight different attributes that you wanted to have your medical students to have. We did the same thing. We sent out a doodle or a questionnaire to all of our faculty, and we said, give us the five top qualities that you think you want in medical students. And then we got responses back, and then we structured our stations on that in the beginning. So you define the qualities that you want. This study shows that if you have three interviewers doing one interview, so it's the same interview, that only about a third of the time will you actually get an applicant who possesses those qualities that you're looking for. Whereas if you do nine interviews by one interviewer, you'll get an applicant with those qualities about three quarters of the time. Now, this doesn't exactly relate to our situation or your situation because you're doing two separate, but you can interpolate between one and three interviews, and it's about between 0.23 and 0.48, that's about a third of the time. So about a third of the time, we're picking people who possess the qualities that we're looking for when we do the standardized. Our current chair of our admissions committee is a very numbers-driven guy, and he says that he said the old way, when you do less than six, it's totally useless. He doesn't believe necessarily in the MMI either. He says it's probably better, but with two, it's totally useless in terms of value added. Here, this slide shows GPA, written score on the MCAT, the physical science, biological science, and verbal reasoning, and performance in the. These are correlations with performance in first and second year coursework, and USMLE steps one and two, and then in third and fourth year clerkships. And you can see that with the metrics, there's a pretty relatively strong, particularly GPA and maybe biological sciences, there's a pretty good correlation between performance in those tests and performance in the first 2 years of school, and maybe even in USMLE performance. And that doesn't take rocket science to figure that out. They're taking tests and studying, just like they did in undergraduate school. But then the correlation with their performance in the third year drops way off with those qualities. And the MMI doesn't correlate very well at all with their performance on the quantitative elements, but correlates very strongly in their performance in the third and fourth year. So that's those two elements.
So we are looking at our, I don't know if you guys have doctoring in your curriculum, doctoring dev, okay, perfect. So we are looking at, so our MMI first class is in the third year, so obviously we're looking at the clerkship to see if we could relate to this data, hopefully, or even better. But we are trying to look at first and second year of doctoring data. Just looking in general, we're doing much better, the number of failures of students struggling based on the MMI, but we want to be able to correlate it data-wise in the first 2 years also. You don't want to wait until third year to see if you got the right class or not. So just wanted to add that. Hopefully we'll have a slide here by next year that will show that data also. So, yes.
But it seems to me that the key point is this is not an either-or issue. This is a both-and issue.
Yes.
So if you take some of the predictive value of GPA and MCATs and add it to the predictive value of MMI, that's where you get the bang.
That's exactly the reason why we went to the MMI, because the way we were, you could argue that a semi-blinded interview, the way you folks are doing it, has, is less bias than an open file interview, because let's face it, especially in the screening process, people look and they see a 40 MCAT and a 3.98 GPA, and bingo, they go to interview, and that's the end. They don't even, I'm not going to say all screeners, but some screeners, that's all they need to say. This is going to be a great student, let's move forward, rather than looking at the entire application holistically. So yes, it's a value added. We're looking at a different set of qualities to get an entire picture of the medical student, of the potential student. And that's the way our admissions committee views the data. When the MMI raters, of course, don't see anything, but when it goes to the committee, they see everything. And so everything gets put together.
It's a really good question. So when we were going through this, we made it very clear that if the screening part is understanding if the applicant potentially qualify for medical school interview, so they're all on the level playing field. We get 500 of those. So, and the interview day, as Frank said, is blinded. We're just looking at them. Do they fit UC Davis culture and vice versa? That's what we're looking for. And then the selection committee is looking at everything, the data point, GPA, MCAT, and then the MMI score. So you now have three data points to measure and make your decision on. So it's not one or the other, it's both. Because one is helping you with the preclinical, the other one is helping you with the clinical years.
Of course, the other reaction is that none of these correlation coefficients are particularly great.
Exactly. And that's the argument that our chair, Peter Franks, would say, why don't you just throw them all up in the air and let them land and pick the first 100 before they hit the ground.
He truly believes that, by the way.
Well, he believes that until proven otherwise.
Yes.
Okay. And of course, any of us that have been involved know that we have our own biases, right? Okay. There's some value in what we do, I hope.
So as you mentioned, Frank was sharing the MMI and why MMI and what is MMI. Some of the facts, at least we have learned, and I think Bev mentioned some of these. The pros obviously are it's more reliable, or reliability, validity. As Frank mentioned, our scenarios are real life, so they're completely non-medical. You know, we initially, when we purchased the McMaster's database, there were a lot of medical-related scenarios, so we kind of fine-tuned them and created our own scenarios, so they're very non-medical scenarios. Standardized, 95% of the applicants, so we have interviewed over 1,500 applicants. This, we do 500 every year, and we've done about 100 this year already. Well, actually more than 100.
Right, we've done about 150.
Yeah, 60. So over 1,500 applicants, and I would say over 95% of the applicants say, this is fairer. What does that mean? Speaking with your wonderful fourth year, Cynthia, and as I was sharing with her, if you, in the old way, we also had two, a faculty and a student interview. Let's say if I came in, Deb, and I dropped the coffee on you, you're a wonderful person, so hopefully you'll still
fairly assess me, but what if I made you mad? Or I didn't know about the UNLV basketball, or I'm a UCLA Bruin fan. You know, little biases that come into play as a result. What the applicants felt was, and we tell applicants, we have a slide on ours, there's 10 faces and 2 sad faces in there, that, you know, even if you flunk on station one because you're very nervous, and you flunk on the last one because whatever reason, you still have 8 independent interviews again, because our raters don't talk to each other. So Frank's doing his 10 before any communication with anyone. So it's truly 10 different scenarios where they're assessed 10 differently. So fair is the key word. Having said all of this, it's not all grandiose, you know, everything's great. With everything, there's always pros and cons. And some of the cons we had to address as we adopted MMI. One, obviously, no opportunity to ask questions about applicant's record. You know, you had a DUI, you struggled in the second year, and whatnot. Less opportunity to sell the school, you know. You sit with me for 45 minutes, I could tell you about the canes and the different things we have, and we could talk about my research or, you know, my different things. So you don't have that opportunity to sell. Or you don't really get to know the applicant if you go to the MMI versus the traditional interview. I think Frank kind of mentioned the standardization. One of the key words is, other than, hi Deb, I'm Roy, nice to meet you, and then have a good day. Everything else, part of the scenario is very focused. Every applicant's going through the same thing. We don't talk about the weather. We don't talk about how we should commute here. Doesn't matter, because we want to be fair to everybody. As you can imagine, small talks also will bias you one way or the other, how you respond and whatnot. So everybody other than hi and bye, the same question. So those are some of the cons that we had to struggle with.
Let me just add that as part of that sell factor, one of the points that Roy makes in the beginning of the day is that he and I are paid to sell the medical school. But the medical students pay to go to our medical school. And so we purposely, as I'm sure you do, but we have our luncheon that's well attended by usually MS1s and 2s. But we also have integrated now this year, well, I guess we started last year, but we've fully integrated this year, our highlights tour. We borrowed that from the University of Michigan when they came out. They borrowed some of our stuff. They call it their hospital highlights tour. The highlights tour is given by our MS4 students. So that, we call it the highlights tour, but really what it is an opportunity for applicants in a group of 5 to query MS4s about what their experience was like at UC Davis. And that is, at the end of the day, and in our surveys that we do, that is really, truly valuable information. The applicants feel supported.
That's the highest rated category, even though the applicants even get to meet the admissions dean in a group of 5, it's even higher than that. And the other thing is, these students, the tour as well as the lunchtime activities, they don't have any part of the interview evaluation, so applicants feel comfortable asking the questions. Obviously, if they do something crazy, the students will let us know, but there's no formal evaluation. So for us, honestly, pre-MMI, this is before 2008, believe it or not, every year we had, as the administrative head, I would see about 5 to 10 real legal issues every year prior to MMI. If there's a problem, you name it, we had it, you know, whether an applicant treated by a faculty wrong way, asked the wrong question, did the wrong thing post-interview. I'm not going to go into the details, but we would literally have 5 to 10 where we will go through legal affairs and go, okay, what do we do? Luckily, nothing came to where we have to go in front of the public, but it came to my desk almost every year, 5 to 10 issues. Since the 3.5 years ago we have adopted, I could literally remember 2 legal issues came forward, and they are not interview related. That would have happened anywhere. Our interview process was similar to you guys. two, you know, a student and a faculty interview, a lot of times one or the other didn't show up, so that you only had one feedback on the one-on-one assessment of the applicant. Furthermore, we tried training, didn't work. We try to feed them, you name it, we require them, you can interview.
It didn't work. We gave them standard questions and qualities to look for, didn't work. Yes, question.
What if there was a marked discrepancy between the two interviewers? How did you
I like that question.
There you go, that's point number seven there.
Bipolar evaluations. So, depend. You know, I had some wonderful conversation this morning with some of your team members. It depends, you know. I hate to say it, but you know, typically the faculties would count it, but I think within our admission selection committee, folks knew the history of the evaluator, you know, so how are they doing? So having said that, it's painful to, based on one person's assessment or even two people.
So you didn't get a third interview?
You know, unfortunately, when interview day happens.
And see, that's a problem that I think delays everything. That if you had a point scale and that there was a discrepancy of more than, let's say, a 5-point scale of 3, then you would get a third interview. But it slows everything down. It slows the application process down. So
right, and the facts show that that third interview would be meaningless.
Yes.
Unless you do 6, and then it starts
to
generate some real meaningful data.
Really good question, Bev. So the next one, feedback quality varied. You know, I may say 10 things bad about the applicants, but at the end of the day, I've made a decision, I'll accept this person. You know, 75%, 85% of my feedback is great applicant. It's selection's problem to reject the applicants, and the selection has never met the applicant, and they have to look through the content and go, okay, Roy is saying that 75% of the applicants he met are great, but we only have 70 seats, right? You guys only have 70 seats, so how do you pick from that list if the interaction that the interviewers had wasn't good or wasn't good quality feedback for you guys? Inconsistent assessment of professionalism. Frank may be asking about the Lakers because he wants to find out more about the applicant. Does he have social skills and trying to gauge him? Roy's asking him because I'm truly interested. Are you really a Laker fan or not? I'm joking about this, but obviously there's a different way you could assess that. Dr. Henderson, our Associate Dean for Admissions and Internal Medicine Residency Director, for example, he went to a school in the East Coast where he actually did his medical school. Luckily, he knew about the Cubs because he's a Giants fan and he got in. Obviously, he had good scores, but he truly, even till today, 20 plus years later, believed that had he not known about the Cubs, I don't know how he would have done on that interview. Now, that doesn't mean everybody does that, but that's just a good small sample. For us, this is probably the most embarrassing for me because I really, really, really believe in customer service no matter what you do. So we would get an applicant fly in, like Cynthia's flying out to Sacramento, to Modesto to do a residency interview. Somebody will fly in and they take a taxi and come to UC Davis. And they'll come in and go, hey, I'm here for the interview. Here's a map. Davis is half hour from here. Good luck. Person's waiting for an interview. And this person just let their taxi go. And Sacramento's not the biggest town with taxis running all around. So, and J Street, you know, you name it, it was all over the place. Scheduling problems. You may do your faculty interview 9 in the morning, but the students only have 12 to 1, so you're sitting around. So some of this is not MMI related, but I'm just sharing some of the issues we had that MMI made sense. Lack of standardization, no matter what we tried, it never worked. We were like threatened that you're not gonna interview if you don't do X, Y. Still, it didn't matter. In fact, even initially when these same people came on MMI, they wouldn't follow instructions. And then Frank and I had a station called Parking Lot Station.
Parallel.
I'm talking about the other, So they wouldn't be involved then, basically, because you weren't following instructions and we could monitor the station to make sure you're assessing the applicant accurately. Bipolar evaluations, you know, two opposite directions.
Exactly what Deb was asking about.
So what do you do with that? You know, chances are, as humans, we probably follow with the negative more, you know, we want to take, because you have many applicants, so your chances are you're going to follow. If somebody has a negative, even though whoever said it, chances are that person's not getting in because you're going to wait for two that you get positive, even though this may be just a missed opportunity. Limited encounter with applicants, so two, as Frank shared quite a bit. We had, at least personally, I wouldn't say low on a traditional, you know, if you look at the survey, but for me, I felt like if somebody come to UC Davis School of Medicine, they may come to the medical school here, or they may tell somebody else to come or not come to UC Davis. They may come for residency, or they may tell someone. They may come as a faculty, they may tell someone. They may become the Steve Jobs of medical doctors, and we may want them to donate to us. So it's basically the image of UC Davis School of Medicine was through admissions, and that score was not acceptable. We probably left up quite a bit along your list, but there were a lot of reasons we needed to go to MMI. So our voyage began, I started in January 2008, and that year in November, WMC meeting had the MMI. Kevin Eva was the presenter, the initial.
Steve Emanuel,
yep.
From the University of Cincinnati, gave
yep.
his information.
By the way, they were very instrumental in our implementation of the MMI, both of them. So the meeting got us started. Frank and I did literally some trips and discussion with different folks to same thing you guys are doing right now. And then Dr. Palmer, our dean at the time, we didn't have to sell it, really. She got the problem, so you're very fortunate, your dean's very supportive. And I think personally, she never shared, but I honestly think there were two reasons why she bought on very quickly. I don't have true percentages, but you know, you guys probably have committee on student promotion, so that take care of anything academic or non-academic issues with students. We had, give or take, about 20% of the student body, the different type of issues, more non-academic than academic. So, and mainly in third year. So that was one piece, you know, from the medical school perspective. The other one is more long-term, as your dean mentioned about the patient satisfaction. If you look at the national figures, they're not pretty in terms of doctor-patient interaction. And I think she saw the, from this, you know, what this could be. So those, I'm sure there are many reasons, as I showed you the laundry list earlier, but those were the two main reasons why we probably got a really quick buy-in by our dean. You had a question?
Just a general question. Do you feel like it has changed the personality of the class, the classes that have gone through that?
So the question is, do we think that this changed the personality of the classes?
Of
each class?
You know, every class sort of has its own personality.
And I would say we've had three full classes, and each class still has its own personality. We did a study the very first year, it was published in Academic Medicine, that showed, they looked at the five different personality characteristics, and showed that for the MMI interview, probably extroversion had some advantageous aspects to it. And so we incorporated into our rater training that information. And this year we're even incorporating into our training implicit association. But we still have classes that are, you know, more gregarious, and some that are more isolated. And, you know, it's each one has its own group. We won't really know for quite a while, you know, the effects of this. We'll have some indication, hopefully, at the end of this year, and then maybe a little bit more next year. But really, it's going to take them going out into residency and ultimately into practice before we'll really know.
Thank you.
Anecdotally,
excellent question.
Yeah, anecdotally, you know, some of the directors have shared, especially the first class, I haven't paid as much close attention because move on to the next project, but the first year we were really interested what happened, and I don't know, was it a class personality or what, but following instructions, you know, the first time go around when you send an email out, small group interaction engagement increased. Now, I haven't done that for the last two classes, to be fair, so it could have been just a class personality. But we've been pleased overall, you know, my, the Committee on Student Promotion dramatically decreased. And I wanna, I'm biased with MMI, just because what we had in place, and we have added a lot of other student support services too, so it's not just the MMI decreasing this, but that's been a great influence. You know, if you don't have, we were talking with your dean about first who and then what, so it was important to bring in the right candidates and then we could do whatnot.
So I wanted to ask a question. So when we're trying to select students for the school, what we're looking for, you know, is good, you know, the purpose of the interview is to get good character. And what we do now, we feel like there's a lot of bias on who does the interview, how they perceive the candidate. But the MMI, one of the, you know, challenges would be to be able to assess the candidates, because it's a kind of a simulated scenario. So a good actor could actually do well. So we're not, so in this case, there could be bias, you know, from the student if they can, you know, be a good actor. Because, so I think the key question is, how do you select scenarios that can actually bring out those two characters?
So that's an excellent question. So the question is, we're looking for students who have good character, and that if someone is, if an applicant is a good actor, they probably could perform better across the different scenarios. So how do we select scenarios to neutralize that? Is that the basic question? And I would say that it's difficult to select scenarios that do that, although the teamwork scenarios are really revealing. We have four teamwork scenarios where they work to accomplish some task or do some duty with one of their co-applicants. And things that come out in the feedback, we ask for critiquing, not fluffball critiques, but real, meaningful, because we say, if you're coming to UC Davis School of Medicine, a very valuable part of your learning experience is going to be critiquing each other, as well as the curriculum and the staff and faculty. And so so that's how we go about doing that part of it. And we purposely make a big part of our training of the raters the fact that that can be an issue. So just because someone is more introverted than someone else doesn't make them less of a physician. Maybe they're more thoughtful, maybe they'll go over it. A differential diagnosis better. And also, I really appreciate you bringing up the point about implicit association, because we all have it. I mean, you've all gone to IA.org, but if you go to Google and go to IA.org, Harvard has now, their Department of Psychology, I think, has, I don't know, they've got about 25 to 30 different tests, for those of you who have gone to the site, and they have hundreds upon hundreds of thousands of people that have taken these tests. And when you're feeling particularly strong and ready to be humbled, go to that site, sign on, you know, I think you have to put some identifying data in, but believe me, it gets lost in the, they aren't, I don't think the FBI's after us. Anyway, it's very humbling, it is, to know that I feel a certain way about someone because they're older, or Roy feels some way because someone is heavier, or whatever it might be. And so that we and we train our raiders specifically in that. And when you've got 10 raiders, we feel that diversity in our class is crucial for strength. And in the same way, we feel that diversity in our raiders is a very important quality. And they will, the diversity in raiders will then bring a diversity of implicit associations. And I don't know if you have this on your list of things to talk about, but I was gonna say, we believe in diversity in the very broadest sense of the word. So I remember when Dr. Nivett was out giving his presentation to us at UC Davis. I went up to him. He's the AAMC head of diversity, and I went up to him because I said, "Dr. Nivett, what is your thought on the definition of diversity?" And he paused, and then he looked at me, and he said, "It's difference." And think of the number of different ways that we're different from each other, right? Whether it's research versus clinical, or whether it's, I mean, there's a thousand ways. Background, obstacles that people have had to overcome, interests in different types of service, whatever it might be.
So just to add on to that, so two things. In terms of our raters, as Frank kind of mentioned, so our raters are not just students and faculty. We have the entire community involved, and there's nurses, staff, whatnot. Obviously, one of the criteria is folks need to have experience as interviewers. So, you know, those of you who are in managerial positions, you interview all the time, and somebody could act through. So part of the responsibility, you know, when you go through certain interviews, you could pick apart, you know, whether the person is just acting or nervous versus the content itself, you know, are they answering the question? And the second piece, as Frank mentioned about the training piece, so we go through the same thing, you know, take out the acting and take out the nervousness, and what's the middle piece is what you need to go through. So those are the two ways we try to do. I don't think MMI is perfect. In fact, we like to call some of the MMI acts, the initial MMI that McMaster started, as traditional MMI, because we have built upon it in the last 4 years that we'll go through. I know we're running short on time, so I'm gonna keep moving forward. Once the dean bought in, we had to go through the admissions leaders and different folks. And like every school, you know, we have differences of opinion and different ways of thinking about doing it, and that, you know, we have a joke in our school, anytime something comes up, "Hey, admissions, what's your thoughts on this?" Related to medical students, you know, it's always, "Admissions, what did you do wrong?" So I think with this, we were trying to get the buy-in. And one thing that some of the folks who are more data-driven really, really liked this was, now you have GPA, MCAT, and MMI score that they really liked. And folks were overall on the same page that, you know, it's not working the current way. So I don't think it was as hard as it could have been.
Right. I would like to add, and then I'll let you go, because I know we have a time limit here. But when you have 10 interviewers, when you only have two, unless someone does something really egregious, it's difficult for a lot of people to make a negative statement about that individual. It's just difficult. People don't like to be the barrier for that person to get into medical school. And when you're one of two, it's more difficult. When you're one of 10, we ask, put in, if they say something, put it in quotes in your comment section. If you have a feeling, put it in there. So the more input that we can get in the comment section, then the committee loves that. And then they can weigh the 10 stations, like Roy said.
So once we have the admissions key leadership buy-in, surprisingly, it wasn't as hard as I thought it could have been, at least thinking back 4 years later. We actually went out and bought student body, staff, different folks to make sure everybody was on the same page. because we were going to go out to the masses to kind of help us with the MMI. We had shortage of faculty interviewers already. That was part of the problem. And this way we could go and have the community involved. Now, one thing, make it clear, the MMI wasn't used to make decisions. It didn't change anything other than traditional interview was taken out and the MMI was put in. The weight for MMI is the same as pre-MMI. It's just, it's done differently, that component. Human and IT, you know, we had to get more support because, as your dean mentioned, it's gonna take some resources to get it done. IT, in real time, logistics, you name it, there's a problem. How many stations? How many qualities do we want to assess? We interview 500 people for 105, so one in five get a chance to get in. So Frank mentioned about the evaluation, so we have to give folks strict guidelines. How many of these 20 people you're going to see today, you could put in the top bucket, next bucket, so four quartiles basically. And they still, even if you put, you know, in a strong day, you are not the strongest applicant, you still have a chance on the back end to make it to the top bucket. But you have to do that in order to get away from most of the people just going, yeah, everybody's great, because you have to give them a real assessment. Desired qualities, we went through, we didn't have our competencies completely in place like we do today. So initially we started with a little survey where we asked for five qualities of student leaders, faculty chairs, dean leadership and whatnot. And based on that, we created 10 stations. And each station, for example, had professionalism, teamwork, diversity,
ethics,
you name it. And within that, we used the McMaster scenarios and kind of fine-tuned them because they're Canadian version of it, so you want to be very careful. You want to make it as easy as possible for the students not to have any confusion between us versus in Canada. You know, some of the things are called differently, and so we had to fine tune that. And then recruitment and training of raters. If you don't go through the training, you are not going in there. In fact, after the initial batch, if somebody new is coming in, we have a parallel rating room where you could kind of monitor the MMI scenario. We make you go through that at least once before you could go live, because we just don't think, even though we have 10 stations, we want a good quality. We want everybody to have a good chance to go through the process, a fair process. Feedback, ongoing enhancement. I literally mean, it's been 4 years and we just made a dramatic change this year. We used to have one actor in five of the stations, and one of the stations we added two people in there basically. I won't share the is this recorded, right? So I won't share it publicly, but this is basically some argument between the two, and then the applicant has to come in and solve the problem. Not that that ever happens, you know. So kind of going, you know, as somebody mentioned to me, you know, that there's training out there for MMI and preparation. So we're trying to get the next level of assessment, you know. So that's where I think the initial scenarios were very traditional MMI. We're going with the next step. Okay, what is the next thing we could do to kind of throw the game off? Basically, the bottom line is trying to assess the student applicants in a real way, you know, try to get the real them out of them. So, and then one of the things we did differently from in 4 years ago, just to give credit where it's due, it wasn't just MMI. We literally changed our whole admissions approach, our student support, you know, approach and whatnot. Within MMI, we actually went through the WMC holistic review process. And so the applicants assessed on their experience, attributes, and metrics, and all three based on MCAS, and MMI does all three. Annually, we get about 6,000 applicants, 3,000 plus get secondary. We don't have a quota, so I want to be very careful there, but give or take, we secondary for about half of the group. And MMI or interview for 500, and we matriculate about 105. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Frank to kind of go over what our MMI looks like.
So, as I said earlier, we feel very strongly we're not looking for people who are already medically oriented, medical doctors, EMTs, or whatever. So we have non-clinical, and this is a slide that we show at orientation the morning of interview day. So we tell them, you're scenarios are going to be non-clinical. They're going to be real life situations that could happen to you. Maybe they already have in life, or they certainly could. And they're short and open-ended. One of the things that we've learned from the McMaster's group of questions is that they tend to be a little long. Like the one we're going to use tonight, long. And because the raters don't know anything about the applicant, they don't know where they went to school, they don't know what their GPA was, they don't know what their MCAT score was, but on the other hand, they don't know where they grew up, they don't know what obstacles they've had to overcome, they don't know what their interests are, research, clinical, whatever it might be. We tell the applicants this, and so we say, we're leaving these scenarios very short and open-ended so that you can bring into each scenario aspects of your life that will reflect your values and your attributes. They're observational. As Roy said, we've gone to 9 of our 10 stations are completely observational, where the raters observe some action that the applicant is doing, either with a standardized patient, and I tell them, these are the same people that are going to be having heart attacks on you next year when you're here, or that you're going to be having to tell they have a terminal illness. And then we have the pathway to medicine, which is their chance for 8 minutes, and we say, well, you own this station. So start thinking about aspects of your MCAS application, personal statement, experiences, maybe things that you've done since you filled out your application, parts of your life, if you want to share parts of your family, whatever it is that you want to, maybe why you want to come to UC Davis, pathway to medicine is your opportunity to share that. And then the assessment, we have gone to quartile rankings. And it's amazing when we do the training, and we do have, I want to emphasize this, take just a moment to emphasize it. We have bank managers, we have sergeants of the university police, we have the council for the university, we have, of course, our faculty members, we have students, we have vice chancellors, we have people from their medical social workers. The nurses have really bought into this, and it's been really empowering, because on the wards, one of the biggest elements of the RUP, you might say, is interaction between all sorts of different staff, and particularly sometimes nurses, and the students. And now nurses feel like they have ownership into the process. So we have all many different aspects. So these are the 3 different types of stations: the role play, which is the standardized patient; the teamwork, which is 2 applicants interacting to accomplish some task that can be fun; and then the pathway to medicine, which is the one that they own themselves. So stations are based on our core competencies. Here are the core competencies that we decided are important to us. And as you as an institution can sit down, define your own core competencies, and I would suggest that you somehow structure with your admissions team scenarios and tailor those scenarios to reflect those core competencies. That's what we've done in the last year. This is what a circuit looks like, 10 stations. What we show the students is that we show the smiley face, but we have 2 of them with a frowny face, and that's because I said we fully expect that at least 2 of the stations, you're gonna walk out of that station and you're gonna go, that was so not me. And we fully expect that, but because, like Roy said earlier, you have 8 stations to make up for.
Thanks, Frank. So, you know, earlier I mentioned the pros and cons. Some of the way we overcame this, and interestingly, as I was looking at this slide, We have about a dozen schools come check out the MMI, has approached us, and we've discussed this with them. Everybody approached these cons very differently. For example, some of the schools didn't really fully go into MMI, but they had like a semi-MMI scenarios in, within their interviews, not going completely on board. Our School of Nursing, Michigan State thought of differently. Michigan thought of differently because of, you know, some of the schools, like for us, we had a dirty laundry list that we needed to change versus things are working for folks, but they wanted to standardize it more. So it's a very different version. You know, this is saying 135 medical school and there's 270 ways of doing things. So MMI is, I think, no difference. It's, so it's really important how you do it. For us, you know, the opportunity to ask questions about applicants' record, we literally have a question on the secondary to ask the applicant, hey, would you like to assess something or share something on the application that you want to let the community know, the committee know what, when, where, and why? Let the applicant do, hey, nothing, that's fine, they could say that, or proactively letting them address anything that they feel like maybe a weak spot or that they want to address to the committee. Also, Pathway to Medicine is another opportunity. They get one-on-one with the faculty member to kind of share their application and whatnot. Less opportunity to sell the school. We had several additional opportunities, actually. But part of that is not because of MMI, I want to again emphasize, but it's overall admissions revamping. We have a meet the dean where, so we have 20 applicants, 10 doing the MMI in the morning and 10 in the afternoon. The group that's not doing the MMI, they do their group of five. One of the five are doing hospital highlights, and the other five are doing a meet the dean for an hour, where our dean meets and kind of sell the admissions dean, sell the school and whatnot. The hospital highlights are mentioned in there, and then we have a lunch with the second year students usually, and some third and fourth year, and then even first years. Then Frank and I, after we implemented the MMI, one of the things we're really proud of is personalized revisit. So like most schools, we have a revisit day once a year in April where, you know, everybody who wants to come and kind of second look. But what we do is the second year accepted that, Frank will give you a call and congratulate you. But at the same time, he's going to be asking you, hey, I'm going to be calling you back in a week. Do you want to come back? What do you want to do? I want to shadow OB, I want to see a baby delivered, or I want to see a surgery happen. So we put a whole day together for you to kind of meet a student, specialty, meet financial aid team, different things. It takes a little effort on our team, but overall we haven't increased the staffing as a whole a lot more. But that has dramatically improved our recruiting. I believe of the students or applicants who were accepted that did the PRE the first year, it was above 50%, Frank. You remember the percent that ended up matriculating?
Two-thirds.
Yeah. So it was pretty high.
And two-thirds of the offers that we made came for the personalized revisit. When you think about, I don't know about your guys's, but when you have one day that you designate as your revisit day and someone can't make the transportation, or there's another school that they want to go to on that day, or you know, some family matter comes up or it costs too much, this way, we let them pick the day. They can do it in advance so they can get a discounted airfare. We don't pick an airfare for them. And then they can pick a specialty. If they want to do trauma surgery, it's amazing. The faculty really buy into it. And I've got a list right there. I say, Dr. Anderson, I've got somebody that really wants to do trauma surgery. Dr. Fong, I have somebody that wants to follow a family medicine doc for a morning clinic, would that be okay? And they do that. And I explain to the applicant, sometimes these surgeries go long, sometimes these clinics run over, so don't be surprised if they can't have lunch, but if they can, we have lunch, we reimburse the faculty for that. Faculty almost never ask for reimbursement for it. And then they come back and spend the rest of the day with the
students. So the amazing thing about this is, I'm sure many of you are actively involved with your admissions, you're like, I'm not taking another thing on. The funny thing is, faculty who are not able to participate in the committees on different things, this is their opportunity to be engaged in the process. You know what, I have my clinical responsibilities, but I'm happy for somebody to tag along. So you could tap into the different group. It doesn't have to be the same group. don't get to know the applicant. The reality is you get to know the applicant really well by 10 different people plus the meet the dean that the Dr. Henderson does for us and the pathway to medicine. So all of the stations, actually, you really do get to know the applicant. Now, depend on what you really want to know. You know, if you want to know about the sports as Roy likes it, maybe you don't get to know that. But as far as communication, different skills you want to look at, what are your core competencies, you do get to know that. And you can create your scenario however way you want to make it. Lessons learned. You know, as I was saying earlier slide, 4 years later, we still like literally tweak it a lot.
The first 6 weeks, we tweaked it every single week.
So you had your LCME visit, and we have ours in January. I have it tattooed over here. So the first 6 weeks was like LCME here every day for 6 weeks, because we really wanted to make it work and make it happen. So applicant feedback, survey in person daily, you know, at the end of the day, we were like, let us know. And we were flexible. Radar feedback per circuit, so every circuit, you know, every time you go through the 10 stations is a circuit. And we also had a quarterly and a yearly feedback session with a, not Frank and I, but a different group to make sure that they didn't feel like Roy and Frank will be hurt. Parallel raters, you know, who are monitoring from the outside or different ways to kind of assess the stations. We have a research education outcome unit evaluation team that also assess the data. For example, we looked at making sure that the, you know, socioeconomic disadvantaged students versus the regular students didn't have disadvantage or advantage. Interestingly, we had two stations that were a little off. The other eight were same. Those two were completely different direction, but if you look at the 10 as a whole, it was perfectly fine. So, and when they tell you to look at the MMI score, don't look at per station, you want to look at the score as a whole. Otherwise, you lost the meaning of the MMI, what the purpose was. Confidentiality was something we were able to put in, and as I mentioned earlier, legally, like two issues in the last 3.5 years. Now, that's not MMI alone, but that has helped a lot, you know, being able to monitor, train, whatnot. Real-time revisions, kid you not, there was MMI going on, and Frank, myself, and our admissions director on the board, something happened, and they're like, oh my God, this applicant's in the wrong spot. We literally real-time, I'm not kidding you, figured out and fixed it. Now, 3-4 years later, it's, we don't even go down there anymore, Frank, unless you're hosting someone. So it works. And, you know, looking at you guys, you know, looking back at our journey, and then same thing for you guys. It's, every MMI, honestly, I could tell you, it has to be for your school will be very different than ours. It's your MMI, you know, your applicant pool is different, your faculty are different, your mission, your competency, everything is different. What you're looking for is different than ours. Just like for us, what's very different than what Cincinnati did or McMaster's did. You know, we always like to say, you know, UC Davis is very, you know, friendly place. So some of the faculty freaked out when we were going to MMI. So it was very important for us to personalize, don't lose that personal touch. So that was constantly reminded to us throughout the process. And you know your core values and what you're about, and you don't want to miss out on that. And MMR won't take it away, but you would have to put efforts into that. Frank mentioned earlier about six stations. If you do anything less than six stations, you might as well just keep the traditional interview and just standardize the questions. We are at 10, and I haven't said it publicly yet, but I think we're going to try to aim for 6 or 7 next year. It's workload, and we want to kind of get more efficient at it. We feel more comfortable now 4 years later. Align your stations scenarios to your desired outcome. For us, it was two things at the highest level. One, the non-academic portion of the medical students during the 4 years, and the other one was, you know, the patient satisfaction, you know, down the line. So those are two reasons, everything we look back at. I think you guys purchased the McMaster scenarios. So I would highly, highly recommend to revise them and not throw at your applicant, because some of their language, English is my fifth language, by the way, even it didn't make sense to me, so I could imagine the applicants might have a hard time at that too. So I mentioned, I think what Frank mentioned earlier about the traditional MMI. MMI is just starting and we're calling it traditional already. So one of the, you know, the traditional MMI is a structured question. There's a stem, you know, applicant approach the scenario, the problem one way or the other, and you just drill down and keep asking follow-up questions. We have, over the last 3.5 years, learned quite a bit to where we actually like our raters to be just observant. They learn a lot more about an applicant versus when you have to engage and when Deb answers, sorry to put you on the spot, Deb, but you know, to think about, okay, how am I gonna counter that argument or counter that question or whatnot is a lot, it's a lot harder for you to do both multitask as good as we are. The other thing is with all the training out there, it's easier to train for a scenario, you know, you go this way and then whatnot versus when there's a human being involved and it's a real life situation. It's a lot different as folks who have seen the SPs and the OSCE and whatnot could tell. In role play, use professional actors. Cannot emphasize enough. We saw some of the places using their students or their staff or undergraduates, day and night different. I think there's a lot of variables, you know, the scenario itself, the station, the raider, the actor or the SP is a big component of that. For your OSCE, imagine putting me in there or somebody else. By the fifth time, I need a lot of Coke or you know, some caffeine, and it won't be the same for the first person versus the seventh. And I could tell you, our SPs are trained, and my God, they're amazing first through the 20th that they go through. And you know, you could highlight your school around the MMI as we have done. And actually, our satisfaction improved by 50% in post-MMI after the first year, where we thought, oh my God, we're gonna lose out on people and whatnot, but we're competing with different schools for many other reasons too, but our satisfaction for the applicants went up by 50% from the pre-MMI to post-MMI.
At the end of the day, the applicants say the MMI is something like a blend of speed dating and reality TV.
And we like it or not, you know, it's not 10 years ago or 20 years ago process. We have to move with the times and get the right candidates in there. And then the last thing on this slide, listen carefully to feedback and be very flexible. You know your school better than anybody else. I don't care who comes in here. I think you have to make your own decisions. What you want, how you want it, and go with it. I think we will be happy to provide as much support as we can, but honestly, you have to decide and go with it and be flexible. You'll learn, oh my God, the first time at my reverb, I couldn't sleep the night before and everything went fine, you know, there were some hiccups.
And your admissions team is 8 steps ahead of where we were at the beginning.
So I think every one of you have a sample scenario in your package. So at this time, we are going to go ahead and go through actual scenario. But before that, Mimi has a question.
Since so many schools are going to MMIs, you talked about training, and you were talking about training us. But like they have developed pathways for the MCATs, have they developed something to coach students so you don't necessarily get what you think you're getting out of the MMI?
So we actually, I sent Frank, I was in the education board building on Saturday working on LCME, and there's a outreach happening that, you know, where students do, and they're doing the scenario, and I sent, literally sent him and my dean the picture of the scenario and go, wow, they're getting trained. So what we did is we are a step ahead of the game. Quite honestly, whether it's traditional interviews, MMI, you know, they get prepared. We joke about at the start of the day, did you Google the MMI? And if you didn't, don't worry about it, you'll be okay. I mean, everybody does the Googling. So
everyone does, right?
Yeah, if we think that the traditional interview, they're not coming prepared, we are kidding ourselves. Yeah. And I think what we did, Mimi, it's a really good question, honestly. What we did is the traditional initial MMI was a lot of STEM-based questions. You kind of, you know, like you, I ask you a question and you go one way and then we keep digging in. The actor base has thrown off, you know, using the SP has thrown off the mix completely different. And with that changing your scenarios, and McMaster actually did a study where they did a study where they showed applicants the scenarios, and these applicants didn't have the scenarios. Didn't make a difference. It didn't matter they knew the scenario before or not, because there were so many other components you're looking at. You know, if you're acting, you're gonna come across, you know, when in a heated exchange or when there's a problem you can't solve, if you're really, it's just like Oscar, you can't act through it. So, I mean, is it perfect? You saw the reliability was like, what, 0.57? It's not. I'm sure there'll be like ZZI or something like that in a couple of years that will adopt.
Yeah, this isn't an answer to your question, but several of our physicians have made the comment, let's face it, in a busy clinic, you have to be able to walk into the room, evaluate the situation, put on your game, gather facts, come up with a differential and a plan in a very short period of time. And maybe we're looking for people that can do that, or that can be taught to do that anyway. So we're looking for many other types as well, but.
So what we're gonna do is try to give you a little flavor of the MMI. At this point, we'll do a sample scenario. And each of you have a scenario in front of you, Dr. Blair's scenario. Please don't read that yet. If you have done it already, okay. But if you haven't, it'll be great if you just hold on. Yes, that's why. So with that, what we're gonna do is, so at this point,
we have a volunteer.
Highly recommended volunteer. So your dean is the applicant in this scenario, and each of you are waiter. In reality, there's a small room and there's only one of you, quite honestly, so each of you just act like you are the only waiter. We would like you to assess, there's an assessment sheet on there too. Frank is gonna be the waiter.
So don't look at the sample scenario quite yet, okay? If you can.
So I'm gonna, at this point, we're gonna give you, go ahead, have a seat. 20 seconds? I like that. So we're gonna give you 30 seconds to read that. Even if you have read it, just read through it one more time and just test yourself and give me about, I'm gonna time it, so give me about, go for it. Your time's up. How many were not done yet? I actually saw folks looking up after 15 seconds. Obviously, most of you may have read it already, but still, we give 2 minutes. So after about 30 to 45 seconds, applicants usually are like, hey, what do I do, where's the candy and whatnot? From now, we're gonna actually go through the actual process.
But think about it. They have 2 minutes to read, and this scenario is one of the traditional MMI scenarios. It's like at least twice as long as the open-ended ones that we use.
So now the applicant's coming into the room and they're gonna sit down and introduce themselves to the waiter.
Hi, my name's Frank. Nice to meet you, Tom. How are you doing today?
Nervous.
Oh, that's understandable, but nice to meet you. Have you read the scenario?
I have.
Okay. If you forget any elements of the scenario, we have a copy of it here on the table, and you can feel free to refer to it. That would be, I think, kind of like a issue for. Okay. So, what do you think about Dr. Blair's behavior, the way he treats his patients?
I don't know what homeopathic means, but it seems like it's something that doesn't work. And so I'm a little concerned that the doctor is giving the
patient something that doesn't work, or at least the doctor thinks it doesn't work. And he doesn't seem to believe in it either. So I'm a little confused as to why he's doing this. He's giving it to people with vague symptoms and says it won't do any harm, but then I'm not sure if he knows what the cause of the symptoms are. And it just seems like there's some deception.
Well, that's understandable. Do you think it's, like you said, he doesn't really understand maybe the exact cause of the symptoms, they're vague. He's not sure whether it's going to help. Do you think it's wrong?
Well, it just seems like he's not being a real doctor. And he's doing some things that don't seem that helpful, kind of deceiving the patient. If the patient found out, there would be a trust issue there.
Why do you think he does this?
Maybe he's just a bad doctor. Or maybe he just cares so much that he wants to find something that would help for symptoms that he doesn't have any other help for.
So at the worst, you'd say it's because he's not a good doctor. At the best, you'd say it's because...
You know, he's trying hard. He's trying to do something that he doesn't have anything else to offer. So maybe he cares so much that he thinks he should try to deceive the patient into feeling better. You know, I've heard about the placebo effect.
Right. So what do you think is the difference between that and what Dr. Blair is practicing here, trying to get to the placebo effect versus what he's doing?
Well, not sure. You know, if the patient found out, that would be a big problem in terms of trust, so that would be bad. He probably thinks he's doing fine. I don't know.
Applicant, you have 1 minute remaining.
So you've described a lot about Dr. Glitter's activities. Do you think that any action should be taken against Dr. Blair?
Well, I don't really know how you would do that. I don't know. I guess if I were a partner, I suppose I might say something about that if I disagree with that. So that might be one thing. If a patient found out, I suppose they might report it to a medical board or something like that.
So if the medical board did find out, or if the community found out, do you think there should be an action against everybody? And if so, what do you think should be done?
I'm still not sure. I've read that there's actually something to the placebo effect, and that there's actually a basis for how it works. So maybe that's what he's doing. Maybe he thinks he's kind of ahead of other people.
This is the end of your station. Please move to the next station. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Very
this
nice
is literally what
you.
Happens.
Tom,
see you. Thank
real
you.
Pleasure.
Thank
you.
Hope I'll be better next time.
Thank you. So we literally do that, actually, even somebody's actually timing in the monitoring room. I was trying to make sure. I did it on purpose in between to kind of show the example of what literally happened in the actual station. So with that, Frank, do you want to go over the assessment piece of the rating?
Sure. So you have a rating sheet in front of you. Each interview is eight minutes, and then there are 2 minutes outside to rotate and go to the next door and read the next scenario. And we have Tic Tacs outside the door, little bottles of water. We say anything that's there is for you. So if they get nervous, there's water.
I really like your question. So what happens is, so they have 2 minutes to read scenario, they come in, then they go out to the next station, somebody's outside reading your scenario. those 2 minutes you kind of jot down your notes if you didn't get a chance during the station. And what you do is you just compile all 10 applicants' information, but you don't make any decision. Once the station, the entire circuit finished, you put all of them out there, and then you start putting them in whatever your system is, whether it's a quartile or you need to rank them 1 through 10, whatever the way you guys need to do it. But you do your note taking in between each station.
You do your note taking, and personally, we give our raters pencils. Okay, so we ask them to write their notes down, and I like to do a preliminary rating. Like if I thought Tom did a great job, I'd put him up on the top, and maybe in light if I wasn't sure, and then or toward the bottom or in the middle. And then when I get my 10 at the end, I put them all out on the examining. We do it in our skill suite. I put them all out on the examining table and stack them up that way. So if you could fill out your rating sheet. You have a rating sheet there? So it's, I think you have a Likert scale from 1 to 7?
No.
1 to 10. We don't use that in the beginning for but you use it, okay? This is a gestalt, and then there's an area for comments. Please write your comments, okay? We aren't gonna ask you to turn these in, so okay, these are for internal use only, okay, for yourself.
Since we're running out of time, perhaps we could just have folks give feedback on the scenario itself rather than go through the whole practice.
Seems like it would be really dependent on the interview.
Could we give him the mic, please, so we can
yes.
hear?
Because you were doing a good job of open-ending questions and, you know, and reflecting back what he was saying, but I guess you make sure that each of the persons doing the interviews are well-trained in communication, because they have to be good at the skills as well as, I guess, the people being interviewed.
Excellent point. So the raters, we call them raters, okay? That way, that stigma of the interview process isn't there, because then that puts a lot of power. Anyway, yes, there's a standardized training that they all go through, realizing how to ask the questions. They're educated on the day that they show up, because they don't know which of the scenarios they're going to have until they show up that morning. So we ask them to show up early. We have a packet, a nice professional leather-bound packet, and one of our staff goes over the scenario with them. So that's a very good point. And we have great raters. You know, it's something that you can't train people to do that. Yes.
What's your training?
Good, great. In the beginning, I did all the training. So, for the first 2 years, I did it all. And then we hired a new director of admissions, Joanna Garcia, and she took it over, and she's doing it all. And she did it all last year. In fact, she did some the year before. And that counts for group training as well as individual. Like in the middle of the year, let's say someone says, I want to get involved, we'll bring them on board and we'll do a one-on-one or two-on-one presentation. It's an hour long. It's about an hour long. And now we're developing one that we should have within a month that'll be online. So that if someone's interested, they can go online, do it at home. They don't have to reach a busy clinic, you know.
Also, that would actually ensure absolutely uniform training, so you would lose some of those variables.
Yep. That's a really good point, Deb.
Yeah, plus Deb, you know, the McMaster's, the part of the package you get, they have a lot of training material that you could put clips in there. Due to time constraints, we didn't put it in there today, but they actually have a same scenario, good, okay, bad, within the same scenario, they'll go over that video. It's like it's a little longer, but
right.
Otherwise you could go through that in training.
So do you have a pool of scenarios for each year? Do you rotate them, and do you keep them the whole year long? And is it like 20, or do you said you're doing 10, I guess, right now.
Right.
Is it 10 every time?
Right.
I guess the second part of the question, too, is you, which you mentioned sort of before, do your Raiders do all 10 of those, or do you have them specifically trained in just a couple of them that they feel comfortable with?
Great questions. Great questions. Right on the button. First of all, generally, we use the same 10 stations all year long. If there's something that happens in a station, or one of our Raiders makes a suggestion, or one of our parallel Raiders makes a suggestion on how to improve it, or one of our applicants makes a suggestion on how to improve it, we'll consider that and maybe improve it. The second part of your question was,
do the Raiders only do like one?
Yes.
Once
every leave that up to the Raiders. If there's a Raider who really loves Station 2, sign up. Because one of the things that we found is the more that a person rates, the better they get. And the more they're willing to put down things that they wouldn't traditionally put down in their comment section in a traditional interview, like most of the quotes.
Yes.
Is it the same, let's say, 10 raters every year? I mean, for each process, or
yes.
Can you interchange?
They interchange.
So you have five one way, and then there's, how many different people do the rating?
Great question. We have about 200 and some signed up. We ask that each does at least five per year. And so they can do, any station that they want.
I guess I don't want to go. So how do you account for the inter-rater variability? You have someone that's always hard, they're not the same, yeah.
Well, first of all, with the display, you'll see the mean at the bottom. And when folks are trained, especially, pardon me, but especially when non-physicians are trained, okay, they follow the rules.
He's an MD,
I want to make sure you know that.
But even the physicians follow the rules very well. And the way we have it now, the mean of if everyone followed the rules perfectly would be a 1.5. And our averages run 1.51, 1.52, sometimes 1.49. It's amazing how people, when they're given the liberty to be not dependent on whether the person gets into school or not, they aren't the single reason that they can make that distinguishing call.
We also have
a great question.
We also have it's part of that the selection committee doesn't get your raw score; they get an adjusted score. So let's say if we have a scale of 0 to 3, I give 3.0s all the time. The score got adjusted versus, let's say you are a really hard rater and you give 1.0. So the score is adjusted, actually.
And we have little talks with folks that are off the, up in the skew area. Yes.
So if you do keep the same scenarios, do you have them sign a confidentiality agreement saying that they're, because I can imagine there's all these medical students sort of blogs out there.
Great question again. Anyone involved in the process at any stage signs a confidentiality agreement. That goes from the dean, the big D dean, to every applicant along the way. So anyone, and they cannot discuss any of the scenarios, and we make a big deal about this, especially with the applicants, at noon, when you're having lunch, and I know you're gonna be kind of a little excited about the interview that you just went through. No discussion, and never. You don't go on the chat line. We spent a lot of work putting this interview process together, and we would really appreciate the integrity that you would show our school if you don't go on studentdoctornetwork.com, or if you don't go on your,
I haven't seen anything on the web at all. Bev, you had a question.
Well, I don't know how to phrase it. What if you have an applicant who's very talkative versus one that's very reticent? Is there some unconscious bias?
I think that that's kind of what you're getting at, sort of the extrovert versus maybe the more introvert. And that study that we did showed that in the MMI, the extrovert has a little bit of an advantage, if you will, over the introvert. And that's why we've directly put that into our training for folks to know that studies show that there is that bias, and to take that into account.
Remember I mentioned earlier, Bev, about the training that looking for not, is a person nervous or a good actor or talkative, whatnot, but the content piece or the meat, if you may. Somebody had a question.
Just for fidelity, are you trying to disk analysis and EQI to bring those into line?
Well, we have our analytic team is looking at a whole host of Z-scores from across the board, from station to station, from interview day to interview day, from rater to rater, and from parallel raters to active raters. By an active rater, I mean one that's actually in the room. We have 3 years of data we're trying to look at to see if that shows up.
I remember I mentioned earlier about doctoring. We're literally actually looking at the doctoring data for doctoring one and two also as we speak. And we did at the socioeconomic portion of it. How does that impact somebody from a disadvantaged background versus not? We 8 of the 10 stations passed the flying colors. The other two were opposite of them.
And we made and the one that was a little against the socioeconomic disadvantage, we made a little bit of a change to this year because it was pretty heavy. Yes.
Because you're trying to look at different evaluation systems, have you seen a difference in the metrics in your classes demographically as well as the other metrics?
So our diversity for the class has improved. We've done decent in the past years, but right the last 2 years our socioeconomic or disadvantaged background has been in the 40%+ of the class who's been from disadvantaged background. Remember, the raters doesn't know anything about an applicant, anything other than meeting them. And our URM portion has also improved. It's been the last 2 years we've been either in the mid-30s or mid-40s. That has improved. Our GPA and MCAT has slightly, well, not completely gone down. You can't make a reasonable, you know, why it happened, but one or two portion of the MCAT went up. The others went down, not significant, but a little bit.
And the AAMC study showed that any portion of the MCAT doesn't, I mean, the myth that the English component means more than any other, it's the total MCAT score that really matters. And our mean MCAT score is about the same.
I'm talking about less than 0.5
right,
drop off.
Right.
We know so. Leadership likes to see those numbers because, you know, you get the ranking and whatnot, but so there has been a subtle drop.
So it's 7:10.
We are way past our time, yes. Frank, as usual. Sorry, Chris.
Okay. So,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Feel free to email us if you have any questions. We're happy to help with the process.
I'm not going to get my rating.
I did want to share this slide with you guys when we went through this whole process. Sometimes you just got to do it. But don't do that.
if we had the clickers, we could find the
meeting.
We could show them what they're trying.
You did great. You accepted with a fully paid scholarship.
You can tell he's a doctor. You know, he said, "You know, what is this? I don't know what allopathic means." Not allopathic, but what does homeopathic mean? And it's those types of questions, you know, when people are honest and upfront and open, those are the candidates that often not do well on the MMI.
Thanks, Chris. Sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah.
No, thank you. So, just really quickly.
Town Hall is really the start of the MMI implementation. We've been researching this over the past couple years, and we've already adopted the AAMC's holistic review process. We adopted that in 2011, so we are looking at things under the waterline of metrics already. And faculty involvement, participation, and engagement in this process as we move forward is key to this. It's key to the success. So you are the key, and you will be hearing from us over the next several months prior to implementation in the 2014 admission cycle. You will be invited to open faculty discussions where you'll have input and recommendations into the actual construct. You will be constructing the construct of the MMI and what you feel are the top priorities as faculty members, as admissions committee members, and as clinicians, what you want to see in your students, in your courses, in your clerkships, and in your residency programs. You'll also be receiving faculty surveys that will ask you what top five characteristics and attributes that you think are most important in applicants. We're forming a faculty steering committee who will be taking all of that into consideration during that time period and as we move into that admission cycle. And then the actual construct will be formulated and employed in the MMI that begins in that admission cycle interview season, which begins in October of 2014. So that's what's coming up, that's what's next. And I'd like to thank Dean Schwenk for his advocacy for this initiative, for his participation as a great applicant.
Could I just ask your involvement here? I really want to see this as a way to get much more faculty engagement, much more faculty involvement, as well as student and maybe resident involvement. If you could take this back to your respective groups, colleagues, fellow students, your chair, your departments, and start to talk about this a bit and start to generate some energy, I would be most appreciative, because I think part of this is the technique, part of this is much more investment by the faculty in this process. It's been fine to this point, but I think we need to take it up a notch in terms of faculty involvement. So if you could do that to your respective units, that would be wonderful.
Thank you, Dean Schwenk. And I'd like to thank Dr. Nieland, our admissions, our assistant dean for admissions, for her leadership in this role, and especially our keynote speakers for being valued colleagues, invaluable in this resource gathering that we've been doing, and continue just to give and give. So thank you so much. That's